session we start to learn about the respiratory system. Now, respiratory system is one of the most important systems in our body. As such, each and every system in our body is important, but then respiratory system is very, very important because it supplies air, it supplies oxygen to our body. So this oxygen supply, it is necessary 24 hours a day. We cannot survive without oxygen, we cannot survive without air. Say, for example, without food, we can survive for a few days, I would say. If you are not given food, nothing to worry about it, huh? You can survive. So, no food, you can survive. No water, for a few days, yes, we can survive. But without air, without oxygen, we can't survive for more than a couple of minutes. So, a regular supply of oxygen is maintained through our respiratory system. And another very important thing is the control of this respiratory system. Respiratory system is automatic control. You don't need to focus, you don't need to pay attention to the process of respiration. It goes on automatically. Right now also, you and me are breathing, but we are not focusing on it. The process is going on. When you are sleeping, when you are writing, when you are reading, when you are working in your office, when you are running, jumping, anything. Throughout the day, 24 hours a day, the process of respiration goes on automatically. We are not aware of it. But if you feel, if you wish, you can control the process of respiration. Say, you can breathe in deep, you can breathe out deep, you can hold your breath for a certain duration of time. So your mind can control the process of respiration. Up to a certain extent, not completely, but up to a certain extent, definitely yes, the mind can control the process of respiration. So, respiratory system is the only system which can be controlled in these two ways, automatic control and mind control. So, the basis of pranayama is that if your mind can control the process of respiration, try to control your respiration so that your mind is controlled. And yoga is all about mind, balancing the mind, controlling the mind. So pranayama is very important from this point of view. The effects at the physical level, they are okay, no problem, it increases the oxygen and other things, that's fine. But then the basic effect of pranayama, or the basic aim of practicing pranayama, is to balance the mind. Another way I can explain, nowadays a different type of yoga has been started. I think you are aware of that yoga, laughter yoga. They have started with laughter yogas. What is this laughter yoga? You just go there and keep laughing. Why? Because you are not happy, but still you laugh. It makes you happy. So when I say I am happy, who is this I? When I smile, who is smiling actually? The muscles here? Or it's somewhere here inside my mind or something? So when I say I'm smiling, it's the mind which is happy and smiling. So similarly, when you control the process of respiration with your mind is controlled. It's a vice versa technique. Mind controlling respiration, so try to control the respiration to get a balanced mind. And when you have a balanced mind, obviously it's a balance between the mind and the body. So that's the basis of pranayama. No other system in our body has these two controls. No other system. No other example. For say heart, can you control your heartbeats? The heart is going on 24 hours a day. It's working. But you can't say, oh heart, you have been working for so long. Take some rest for next half a minute. Can you do that? Can you stop the heartbeats for half a minute? Practically not possible, because the control of our heart is totally automatic. Your mind cannot control it. Your will cannot control it. So with this basic understanding, first we will just try to understand the structure of the respiratory system, and then we'll try to understand a few of its correlation with the pranayama practices. Now, I think everyone is very well aware that the respiratory system, it starts with the nose. So we have a nose, two nostrils, the right and the left nostril. Interestingly, at any given time throughout the day, we are utilizing only one nostril, either the right or the left. You can check it if you want. Only one nostril is working at a time, and it works for nearly 90 minutes. The cycle is of 90 minutes. So you breathe in through the right nostril for 90 minutes. Then after that, you breathe with the left nostril for 90 minutes. Again, the right for 90, left 90. On an average, it's not exactly the clock time, but then on an average, it's 90 minutes of one nostril working at a time. For some time duration, when there is a shift from the right to left or left to right, for certain time duration only, both the nostrils are working. Otherwise, it's only one nostril. Yoga has given significance to these nostrils also. Like when you breathe in through the right nostril, the effect is different on your mind and body. When you breathe in through the left nostril, the effect is different on the mind and body. It's a separate thing which can be talked of, but that's not the aim where we are going to talk about it here. We'll just consider for anatomical point of view, left and right nostril, whatever, it doesn't make any difference. That's what I can say. So you breathe in through the nostrils, the air enters inside, goes to the throat, and from the throat, it goes to the trachea. The blue thing in the picture, what you can see, it's the trachea, or in simple words, I would say it is the wind tube. The esophagus was the food tube. This, what we are talking of, is the trachea. If I just need to show you a simplified diagram, this is a simplified diagram. Nose is not shown here. So centrally, we have one single trachea. It's a tube. It's a flexible, elastic tube made up of muscles and cartilages. So it's a muscle, it's a cartilage. So it's a flexible tube. So the central one, one single trachea, it divides into two major branches, a right side and the left side. So one trachea dividing into two branches, and those two branches, you can see further, they are divided into smaller and smaller and smaller branches. And the smallest branch is at a microscopic level. You can just imagine in front of your eyes a tree. Simple, any tree. It has one single trunk. Then it divides into two branches. Those two branches, they further have smaller branches. Those smaller branches, they further have smaller and smaller and smaller branches. And at the end of the smallest branch, the tree has leaves. So here, similarly, at the end of the smallest branch, we have alveoli. These rounded structures, what you see, they are the, they are the alveoli. Now these alveoli, you can simply call them as air sacs, simple word, air sacs which are filled up with air. So these alveoli, they are at a microscopic level. What you see here is just an enlarged picture of it. They are very microscopic, and they are millions and millions of them in our lungs. Millions of them. You can't count them if there are millions of them. So these alveoli, they are further covered with small, very minute capillary blood supply. You can see the red capillaries, the red blood flow over the surface. And through this, the blood would be flowing. So when you breathe in, the air enters into the trachea, the branches of the trachea, it goes to the alveoli, and from the alveoli, you absorb the oxygen in your blood. So as it is in a close contact, if this is the alveoli and the blood is flowing over it, from the alveoli, the oxygen will enter in our blood. And at the same time, the carbon dioxide from our blood, it will enter into the alveoli. So the process of exchanging gases, it takes place at the level of alveoli. So again, I repeat, because it's important, you breathe in the air, goes into the trachea, enters into the branches of the trachea, the smaller and smaller and smaller branches of the trachea, and in the end goes to the level of the alveoli. From the alveoli, you just pick up the oxygen, you absorb the oxygen inside the blood, and the carbon from our blood, it is drained into the alveoli. And once the carbon is drained into the alveoli, you breathe out. So when you breathe out, you just throw out the carbon dioxide. And again, you breathe in and you breathe in oxygen, you throw out carbon dioxide, the process will go on. Now this process, this is as far as the structure is concerned. Now this whole structure, you can see here, it is enclosed in a bag. It's enclosed in a membrane. The branches of the trachea, the alveoli, and the blood circulation. All of it is enclosed in a bag, in a membrane, and this complete bag, we call it as the lungs. So lungs is not a separate organ as such. It's all these things together, we call it as a lungs. So left side lung and right side lung, two of them we have. Now, after understanding the structure of the respiratory system, let us try to understand the functioning of the respiratory system. Breathing in and breathing out, that's the process what goes on. So we breathe in and we breathe out continuously 24 hours a day, on an average 14 to 18 breaths per minute. That's the normal respiratory rate, 14 times to 18 times per minute for human beings. So you breathe in and then you breathe out. Now, when you breathe in, or for breathing in, two things need to happen. You can see in the picture there is a horizontal muscle at the bottom, the red strip you can see. That's the muscle which is called as the diaphragm. Or in simple word, I would say it is the respiratory muscle. So this muscle, the horizontal muscle, it contracts and it is pulled down. A muscle, it's, so it can be contracted, so it is pulled downwards. So the diaphragm, it will be slightly pulled downwards. Now because of this downward contraction of the muscle, the space inside our chest, it increases because the muscle is pulled down. So the space available here is more. At the same time, the ribs, we have total of 24 ribs. Ribs is a structure which is a bony structure which starts from your backbone. It goes from the side and it is connected with the chest bone. So we have total 24 of them, 12 on the right side, 12 on the left side. So these ribs, they come forwards and upwards. So this is actually, you can look at my fingers, this is actually the movement of our chest. It's forwards and at the same time it's upwards. So this is the movement. It's not only this. It is this movement which increases the space inside our chest. So the diaphragm going down, number one, and the ribs moving in this direction, the space available inside the lungs, inside the chest is more. And when there is space available, you breathe in, or the air enters through your nose, goes to the trachea and inside the lungs. So that's the process of breathing in. And once the process of breathing in is completed, immediately the process of breathing out will start. But then breathing out is a simple process. Why simple? Because the muscle, the diaphragm, which has contracted and gone down, any muscle after contraction, it wants to relax. So this diaphragm which is going down, it will again come back to its natural original position because of relaxation of the muscle. So the diaphragm goes back to the natural position. The ribs which are in this position, they also want to go back to their normal natural position. So the ribs will also go back. So the diaphragm coming up and the ribs going back to their natural original position, it creates a compression inside the chest, inside the lungs. The pressure is increased, space available is less. So the air comes out. That's the process of breathing out. And again, the same thing will start alternately. Breathe in, breathe out, breathe in, breathe out. Now this breathing in and breathing out, it's an alternate process. You can't breathe in and breathe out at the same time. Either you are breathing in or either you are breathing out. Both the things at the same time is not possible. So it is compared with the switch on and off mechanism. Like for example, the lights here, they are switched on. Then you go to the button and switch off the button, the lights is switched off. But can you say at the same point that the light is switched on and off at the same time? not possible. So it's a switch on off mechanism. Either you are breathing in or you are breathing out. And further, now you have started with your deep breathing techniques. In deep breathing also, the process of breathing out is given more significance. Like you breathe in four counts. And when you are breathing out, now by this time, I think you have started breathing out in eight counts. So you breathe in four counts, breathe out eight counts. Why? Yoga has given more importance for the process of breathing out. There are a couple of reasons behind it. Number one, breathing out is a passive process. And breathing in is an active process. What do I mean by that? When you breathe in, the diaphragm contracts. It's a muscle, and this muscle contracting, will it come for free? Nothing in this world is for free. So you need to consume energy. Energy is consumed for the contraction of the diaphragm. So you need energy, the diaphragm contracts. And when the diaphragm is relaxing, do you need energy for relaxing a muscle? You need energy, but very less amounts of energy to relax the muscle. If you are contracting a muscle, you need large amounts of energy. But if you are relaxing a muscle, you need less amounts of energy. So when you breathe in, it is considered as an active process. And when you breathe out, it is considered as a passive process. It will happen automatically. When you breathe in, it's a compulsory mechanism that you should breathe out. You cannot stop without breathing out. Simple thing I can mention here. When a person is dead, what do you say? You say he breathed out his last. Do you say he breathed in his last? Never. What we say is he breathed out his last. So even if you have to die, you have to breathe out and then you have to die. You can't breathe in and die. Practically, it is not possible from anatomical point of view. Breathing in and dying is not possible. You breathe in, you breathe out, and then you die. So it's a compulsory mechanism, a passive compulsory mechanism. And what yoga says, if it's a passive mechanism, actively take control over it. If it's happening passively, actively take control over the mechanism. So breathing out is given more significance. Another important thing is, when you breathe out, your parasympathetic nervous system is stimulated. Like the calming effect, the relaxing effect is seen when you are breathing out. So if you give long time duration for the process of breathing out, you will achieve more relaxation, you will achieve more calming down of the body. And it is needed with our modern life, because continuously we are stressed. We don't need that stress. We need to relax, we need to calm down. So if you give more time for the breathing out process, your mind will be calmed down more, you will be relaxed more, because the parasympathetic nervous system is stimulated. We'll talk about the system sometime later, but for the time being, you can just say the parasympathetic system is stimulated. This is observed even in our day-to-day breathing also, in a normal breathing also. Like when you are breathing in, slightly the heart rate is increased. And when you breathe out, slightly the heart rate is reduced. So if you give time, more time for breathing out, you can actually slow down your heart rate. So yoga gives more significance for breathing out. Like you breathe in four counts and you breathe out in eight counts, then maybe you breathe in four counts and you breathe out in 12 counts. So you increase the time duration of breathing out. So this is now, I would say, in short, about the structure of the respiratory system and the way the respiratory system is functional. Now straight away, we'll try to correlate it with some of the effects of pranayama. And to know the effects of pranayama, to understand the effects of pranayama, there is some statistical analysis in front of you, which is called as the lung volumes. You can actually go and measure the lung volumes for yourselves. It's not a big job. It's not a big deal. You can just check it, go to the hospital, and you can check how much air you are breathing in and out. Everything can be analyzed. So these are the averages of individuals. So the first thing which you can see in the list is tidal capacity, and it is mentioned to be 500 milliliters of air. Milliliters, or I have mentioned it cc here, the ideal way to measure. CC is cubic centimeter, but then you can just say milliliters of air. So 500 milliliters of air. Tidal capacity for human beings is 500 milliliters of air. What does that mean? A simple understanding. It is the amount of air which you breathe in one single breath. There is one addition to that. When you are physically and mentally calm and quiet. That's important, because your breathing changes with your physical and mental activity. So physically, you are sitting calm and quiet. Mentally, no stress, no worry, no tension. So the amount of air which you are breathing in this condition, in one breath, is called as the tidal volume. And it is around 500 milliliters of air. Now, immediately, I would like you people to pay attention to something which has been mentioned as vital capacity. It has been mentioned to be 4,500 milliliters of air. Vital capacity, 4,500 milliliters of air. So what is this vital capacity? A simple explanation. Vital capacity is the maximum amount of air which you can breathe in one single breath. Interesting, I repeat, vital capacity is the maximum amount of air which you can breathe in one single breath. So when you are sitting in a meditative pose and then your teacher tells, take in a deep breath. So what you do is, take in a complete deep breath in, that is around 4,500 milliliters. Around 4,500. So in a regular breathing, you breathe in only 500, and when you take in a deep breath, you breathe in 4,500 milliliters of air. So actually, God has gifted us with the capacity to breathe in 4,500 in one single breath. We have been gifted that capacity. Our lungs have that capacity to breathe in 4,500. And what we are doing? We are satisfied with 500. Each breath 500, I am satisfied with that. So one thing about pranayam which is mentioned, and maybe many people are having interest in about the statement which is meant about the effects of pranayam, that pranayam, it slows down the respiratory rate. Somewhere or the other you might have heard it or read it somewhere, that if you keep practicing pranayam, it will slow down your respiratory rate. And at the same time, it has been mentioned that pranayam, it increases your lifespan. Very interesting. Your lifespan can increase with practice of pranayam. How? Let us explain that. So we will explain it with a statistical example. A healthy person, normal healthy individual, having no complaints, no diseases. So this healthy individual is breathing in 500 milliliters of air in one breath. And he is breathing in 14 times in 1 minute, like the normal respiratory rate, what we said. So this gentleman is breathing in 14 times a minute, normal respiration, and he is breathing in 500 milliliters of air in one single breath. So the calculation says that in 1 minute, this gentleman needs 7 liters of air to survive. Fair enough, right? 14 times breathing in, 14 times, each time taking in 500 milliliters. So in 1 minute, he requires 7 liters of air, and he's happy with that. No complaints, healthy, physically totally fit, no complaints. Now, one fine morning, this gentleman joins a yoga class. Maybe some of you as yoga teachers comes to you and starts yoga practices. After a few days, starts just deep breathing, no pranayam, just deep breathing. Does the deep breathing and pranayam and other things for maybe 6 months, maybe 1 year. When actually you are doing that deep breathing exercise, what you are doing? Say 5 minutes a day in the morning when you are taking in deep breath. as a pranayama practice. What you are doing actually, for those 5 minutes, you are breathing in 4,500, right? Because it's a deep breath, complete deep breath. So you are breathing in 4,500. So for 5 minutes, your brain gets that 4,500 number. And the brain starts thinking, as I said earlier also, brain is not a stupid thing. So for 5 minutes, you are breathing in 4,500. And for remaining 23 hours and 55 minutes, what you are doing? You are breathing in only 500. So the brain starts calculating. If it is possible for me to breathe in one single breath 4,500 milliliters of air, why am I doing this only for 5 minutes? Why I am not doing this for 24 hours a day? Right? Because it's beneficial. Just breathe in one go 4,500. You are happy with that. Why only 5 minutes or 10 minutes of pranayama? Can I do it for 24 hours a day? So instead of breathing in 500 milliliters of air throughout the day, the brain is reprogrammed. Our brain is reprogrammable. The brain is reprogrammed, and what the program says, you can breathe in 4,500. Try for it. Practically, maybe it is not possible. Practically, maybe not possible. But from 500, you can reprogram your brain maybe up to 700. Just a small increase. Instead of going to 4,500, that's a big amount. But maybe the brain is not able to achieve that. You achieve only from 500 to 700. So now what happens is, instead of breathing in 500 milliliters of air in one breath, this gentleman has started breathing in 700 milliliters. Maximum possible, again I repeat, it's 4,500. But forget about that maximum thing. This gentleman goes from 500 to 700 milliliters per breath. So now what he is doing? 700 milliliters per breath. And his requirement, what we calculated was? In 1 minute, it was 7 liters. So in one breath now, he is having 700 milliliters. So how many times he has to breathe in to get that 7 liters in 1 minute? It's just 10 times. So initially, he was breathing in 14 times a minute, getting 7 liters of air. And now what he is doing? He is breathing in 10 times a minute, but still getting the same quantity of air. So that's how the respiratory rate has slowed down because of increase in the tidal capacity from 500 to 700. Just a small increase, which is practically possible for you and me. It's practically possible for a common man. Maximum possible is 4,500. Forget about it. We don't want to go to that level. But then if you just increase your tidal capacity from 500 to 700, your respiratory rate has gone down by 4 breaths per minute. So that's how respiration can slow down, the respiratory rate can come down. Of course, another question comes up. Why you want to go and interfere in the respiratory rate? You was a healthy person, no complaints, no trouble, no diseases, and still you want to go and interfere and bring down the respiration from 14 to 10. What is the advantage? The advantage is you are going to conserve energy. The energy requirement will be reduced. Why? Because as I said earlier, nothing comes for free. You are breathing in and out, so it requires energy. So the energy requirement initially was 14 times a minute, but now the respiration has gone down to 10 times a minute. So the diaphragm is moving only 10 times in 1 minute. So you are saving the energy for the movement of the diaphragm 4 times a minute. That energy is saved. That energy requirement is less. 4 contractions of the diaphragm in 1 minute. Go on calculating how many contractions of the diaphragm in 60 minutes, how many contractions in 24 hours, 1 week, 1 month, 1 year, and throughout your life. So that much amount of energy requirement of the body is going to become less. And if the energy requirement of the body becomes less, what should be the effect? Ideally, the effect on your eating, your appetite.
Yes.
You should eat less. Because the body is saying, I don't need this much energy. So you eat less. And if you eat less, what would be the effect? Digestion also is a process. It requires energy. To digest the food, you need energy. So if you are eating less, the process of digestion also will require less energy. For example, if you are eating four breads, it will require energy to digest the four breads. But if you start eating only three bread, you will require less energy to digest those three bread. So the process of digestion will also require less amounts of energy. And the process will go on. So the basic requirement of the energy by our body will be reduced. And this is what is called as the basal metabolic rate. We come to this point now. Yesterday we were talking about it. In previous sessions we were talking about it. The basal metabolic rate. What is this basal metabolic rate? The medical understanding is too difficult for this. We'll try to simplify the understanding for basal metabolic rate. So I'll just tell you an example. Say for example, you are lying down in Shavasana. Yog Nidra, you love practicing Yog Nidra. So you're just lying down in Shavasana. So when you are in Shavasana, does your body needs energy? You are completely mentally and physically relaxed, but still your body needs energy. Why? Because the brain is functional. Your heart is working. What about your respiration? You are in Shavasana, but your respiration is working. Digestion somewhere or the other is going on. The liver, it's working. The kidney, they are working. So you are just lying down. No physical activity, no mental activity, you are just lying down, but still your body requires some energy to keep your brain functional, to keep your lungs functional, to keep your heart functional, to keep your kidneys, liver, digestive system functional. So I would say this is the baseline. This is the basic amount of energy which you require to keep yourselves alive, I would say, or to keep the most vital functions of your body going on. So if your respiratory system starts saying, I don't need to require this much energy, I will work with less amounts of energy, what would happen? Energy requirement is less. The heart also says, I don't need this much energy, I will work with less energy. Energy requirement is less. The digestive system says, I don't need this much energy for digestion, I will digest with less amounts of energy. So the energy requirement for the basic functions, it reduces. And that is possible with yogic practices. And so when the energy requirement reduces, obviously you will consume less. And that is the whole concept about slowing down of metabolism with yogic practices. It is a healthy slowdown. It's not a slowing down of metabolism and you becoming fat and hypothyroidism and other things. We are not talking about that. We are talking about the input and output ratio. So you need less energy, but the efficiency is increased. That's interesting. Like in our example, what we talked of, you were breathing in 14 times initially and getting 7 liters. But now what you are doing? You are breathing in only 10 times. So the energy requirement is less, but still you are getting 7 liters of air. So the output is more. That's what is the concept of metabolism from yogic point of view. I usually give the example of car. Most of us, we drive cars. So maybe if I have two cars, same model, same engine, same company, interior, exterior, color, and everything is the same. No change, absolutely nothing is different. The road is the same, the driver is the same, the driving conditions are the same. Everything is the same. The speed is also the same. I put 1 liter of fuel in each car. Car 1 and car 2. Car 1 covers a distance of 15 kilometers in 1 liter of fuel. And car 2 covers a distance of maybe 12 kilometers in the same quantity of fuel. Now if I have to sell one of those cars, obviously you will prefer car number 1 which covers 15 kilometers. You would not go for the car number 2 which covers only 12 kilometers. Why? Because the quantity of the fuel was the same, but how efficiently the engine is utilizing that fuel It depends that how long the car is going to go. So same way, we are increasing the efficient utilization of fuel with the practices of yoga and pranayama. So that's the concept of metabolism. And that's what we are aiming with yogic practices. And so in the muscles lecture also, I mentioned that you are working your muscles with less oxygen. So if you work your muscles with less oxygen, what's going to happen? The muscles are demanding less oxygen. So the respiratory system has to absorb less oxygen. So the workload of the respiratory system is reduced further. So in this way, one process is associated with the other process and the metabolism can slow down. And once the metabolism is slowed down, the wear and tear of your body cells is slowed down. Wear and tear, like with daily use, the wear and tear goes on. So that wear and tear will slow down. So the process of replacing the cells in your body, it will slow down. So for example, we talked about in previous sessions, we talked about the skin cell, 21 days. It survives for 21 days. But if this skin cell, the wear and tear is slowed down, if the skin cell starts surviving for 25 days, what would happen? Instead of the cycle or the replacement every 21 days for the skin cell, now the skin cell is being replaced every 25 days. So what's happening is, you are also conserving your energy for the formation of new cells. It was initially every 21 days, now it's every 25 days. So you are conserving that energy. And that cell life has increased. So if the cell life is increased, obviously the tissue life will increase, the organ life will increase, the system life will increase, and the body, whole body life will increase. The whole process is about slowing down the aging. Slowing down the aging process. And this aging process, it starts the day you are born. The day you are born, the aging process starts. There is a young kid, 5 years, and when we tell the age of this kid, what do we say? Oh yes, this kid, 5 years old. What do you mean by that? 5 years old? It means that the aging process has already started. It's fine that you say, okay, he's a 60 years or 80 years old man. But for a kid also, you say, oh, 2 years old, 3 years old, 5 years old. Why old? Because the aging has started. So yoga practices can slow down the aging processes. And that's how we say that the lifespan increases with yoga practices. Now it's your trouble what you are going to do with this increased lifespan. Because this small life itself becoming a trouble, this increased lifespan extra, what you are going to do, you can decide about it. So we go to the next point. This was about metabolism. We go to another point, which is related with holding of breath. Now, because pranayama, when we talk of pranayama, it's basically holding the breath. So what happens during this holding of breath? We'll just try to discuss about it. So there is another analysis in front of you. The analysis of gases which you breathe in and out. So it's very clear from the chart in front of you that when you breathe in 21% of oxygen. And when you breathe out 16% of oxygen. What does that mean? It simply means that you take efforts to get in that 21% of oxygen, but your body, your blood cannot absorb that all 21% of oxygen. Practically, it is not possible. Why? Because the carbon dioxide in your lungs, it starts increasing. And the brain says, hey, there is carbon dioxide in the lungs, just throw it out first. We can get oxygen afterwards, but first throw out the carbon dioxide. So each time you breathe in, you can just absorb 5% of oxygen. Now here, the concept of breath holding, it has significance. So there are different types of breath holding. First, what we are discussing is internal breath holding. I'll just explain it in short and then we'll come to the explanation what happens. So we are talking about internal breath holding. Internal breath holding is you take in a deep breath as much as possible and then hold your breath as long as possible with the three locks, the three bandhas. and then you breathe out. So what you are doing is you breathe in, then hold your breath, and then you breathe out. So let us try to understand what would happen when you are holding the breath. So you breathe in deep, you take 21% of oxygen, and now you are holding it. You are not breathing out, you are not breathing it, you are just holding the breath. So it gives time for the oxygen to remain in your lungs for a longer time because you are holding your breath. So the oxygen will remain in the lungs for a longer time. And if it remains in the lungs for a longer time, you can absorb more oxygen. So more oxygen absorption is possible when you hold your breath. And then a point comes when you can't hold your breath, right? If you try it on yourself also, that you breathe in and hold your breath. A point comes when you can't hold the breath beyond a certain level. That is the point when the carbon dioxide levels in your lungs, they have increased. Like on one way, you are absorbing more of oxygen. That's a good thing. But then the carbon dioxide from your blood, it is entering in your lungs in large quantities because you are holding the breath. So that carbon dioxide in your lungs, it actually triggers your brain. And when the carbon dioxide levels, they reach maybe maximum up to 7%, the brain gets a trigger. Hey, so much of carbon dioxide in the lungs, what is to be done with that? And the brain says, hey stupid, why you are holding the breath? Throw out the carbon dioxide. And you say, oh, I have too much of oxygen here, I want to absorb the oxygen. The brain says, forget about that oxygen. First, this 7% of carbon dioxide, throw it out. That's the cutoff point. You feel, okay, beyond this you can't hold. That's practically not possible. That's the cutoff point, 7% of carbon dioxide. You can't hold your breath beyond that. Now with yogic practices, you can actually program your brain to hold your breath for longer and longer and longer times. That is possible. So that you can go on absorbing more and more and more of oxygen. So this will happen with internal breath holding. You get more oxygen and at the same time you wash out more carbon dioxide from your blood. So that's the benefit of internal breath holding. And you can go on programming your brain to increase the time duration of holding the breath, so that you get more and more and more of oxygen. Another type of breath holding is external breath holding. We have finished with the internal breath holding. Now we come to the second type. It's the external breath holding. So the process in short is you breathe in, take in a deep breath, then you breathe out maximum possible breathing out. As much as possible, you just breathe out. And after breathing out is completed, then you hold your breath. Okay, again, I repeat the procedure. You breathe in, deep breathe in, then deep breathe out. And after breathing out is completed, then you hold your breath. Now, what would happen in this? You have breathed out completely and now you are holding your breath. But when I say you have breathed out completely, it doesn't mean that you have created a vacuum in your lungs. Practically, it is not possible that you create a vacuum. You can't breathe out all the air from your lungs. Practically, it is not possible. Some amount of air, it still remains in your lungs. And that amount of air is called as the residual volume air. 1350 milliliters of air, it still remains in your lungs. Whatever efforts you take to breathe out, still that much amount of air will remain in your lungs. Now what's happening? You have this much amount of air in your lungs. So there is some oxygen in it. You keep absorbing that oxygen. At the same time, the carbon dioxide is being accumulated in your lungs, in your blood. So the levels of carbon dioxide, they are increasing here. Now, is it bad to increase the levels of carbon dioxide? Actually, it is not bad. High levels of carbon dioxide, they are good trigger to your brain to reprogram the respiratory centers. How? I will explain it. We go back to the statistical analysis of inspired and expired gases, and I'll give you an example of mouth-to-mouth breathing. I think everyone has heard this term, mouth-to-mouth breathing. So you give it in emergency situations when you don't have the oxygen cylinders and mask and everything, and the person is not breathing, maybe someone drowning, and you pull out the person from the water, you just remove the water from the system, and the person is not breathing, so you give mouth-to-mouth breathing. So how do you give this mouth-to-mouth breathing actually? You breathe in yourselves, and then you open up your mouth and breathe out in the person's mouth. So now when you are breathing out in the person's mouth, again you do the same thing. You breathe in and again you breathe out into the person's mouth. You go on repeating this. So when you are breathing out in the person's mouth, what you are doing? What you are giving to the person? It's 16% oxygen, 79% of nitrogen, and 5% of carbon dioxide. So that 16% of oxygen, when it goes to the patient's lungs, the body takes it, the blood takes it for survival. The patient is alive, so the systems are going on. So the 16% oxygen will be used up by the body. The nitrogen is of no use. It's a neutral gas as far as human beings are concerned. So nitrogen has no role to play. But then that 5% carbon dioxide goes into the lungs. It will go nowhere. It will remain in the lungs. Again, next time you breathe out in the patient's mouth, again you give 5% carbon dioxide. The third time you breathe out, again you give 5% of carbon dioxide. So this carbon dioxide, it goes on accumulating in the patient's lungs. And a point comes when the carbon dioxide levels are so large that it sends a trigger to the brain. Hey, so much of carbon dioxide in the lungs, what is to be done? Breathe out. And the moment the patient breathes out, after that he will breathe in. Switch on off mechanism, I told you, breathe in, breathe out, breathe in, breathe out. So the person starts breathing out because of high levels of carbon dioxide. So mouth-to-mouth breathing works on a principle that high levels of carbon dioxide stimulates your brain. So similarly, coming back to our external breath holding. In external breath holding, I said the carbon dioxide levels, they will build up in your lungs, in your blood, and oxygen levels will be less in your lungs, in your blood. So when the oxygen levels are less, what's going to happen? The brain detects, hey, less oxygen coming to me. What's something wrong somewhere? Why so much less oxygen? So in these conditions, actually, the extra capillary networks which are around the brain, they open up. The capillary networks, the blood supply, the blood channels, which are usually not used in our day-to-day life, those channels, those capillaries, they open up and the blood starts flowing through those capillaries. Because the brain detects that there is less of oxygen and too much of carbon dioxide, and I want oxygen. So how I can get more oxygen? By opening up more channels, by opening up more capillaries. So those capillaries which are dormant, which are not used in day-to-day life, those capillaries, they open up, and that's the benefit of external breath holding. I'll give you an example. For example, you are driving on a road and there is a traffic jam maybe on the road. So what usually you try to do? If there is a chance, you'll try to turn in some small street, some small road, and then maybe just bypass that traffic jam and take the other way. Usually you don't take that other way. Why you are going to that small road? Because there is a traffic jam on the main road. So when the brain is receiving less oxygen through the main capillaries, it tries to open up new capillaries so that the blood circulation around the brain is improved, and same thing about the other organs. So it opens up new capillary channels which will further improve the circulation of blood in our body. So that's the effect of external breath holding. When you hold the breath after breathing out. So in this, we just in short try to understood what are the benefits of holding the breath, and as we were talking about the basal metabolic rate. there are different types of pranayam. All those 8 different types of pranayam are having different benefits, advantages, but then in this short we are not going to complete that. It would be a different thing what we can discuss about each pranayam and the effects of all those pranayams. But in general, overall, we try to discuss the advantages of the pranayam in short. So I think I should stop here for the time being. Hari Om.